Welcome to our Rahner Township Design Review Board meeting. Before we get started, I'm going to ask Jason to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Sure. Wouldn't mind standing, and I'll direct you to your left. Here's the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, guys.
Okay. Okay, before we get started, just a couple ground rules we'd ask you. If you haven't already done so, to please turn off your cell phones. And when you're called and approach the podium, please speak loudly. Let us know who you are, the business you represent, and you can lay your plans out at the table next to the podium. So we'll get started tonight with the first application of DRB 2019-04. It's a continuation from last month at Tower Health at 635 Conister Road in Villanova. And the applicant has asked for a further continuation. So can we make a motion to continue that till the May meeting?
I will move to...
We'll move to continue?
Second.
Okay.
All right.
Good.
All in favor?
All right, so we'll see them in May. So the next applicant is DRB 2019-07, the application of the Emerson Group at 409, 411, and 413 is East Lancaster Avenue in Wayne for a building addition. Good evening.
Good evening. I'm Paul Bloomfield, Bloomfield Architects, here on behalf of Scott Emerson, the Emerson Group. This project involves three buildings on East Lancaster Avenue, one existing building to remain and one that's being renovated. Shown here on this overview, the existing building at 409 is to remain, and the current building at 413 is being renovated now. And then there's a proposal to make a connecting building element that will bridge all these and make it into one building. These are elevations that show all four sides of the proposed project. You can see the existing 409 building at the extreme end, and the opposite side has a bookend building. It was built at the same time. These are about 1900, the original manor homes that are still on the site. So these are being renovated now and will be finished in the same finishes on the exterior and so forth. And then this center section is the new portion that will connect the two. This is the top view is showing the Lancaster Avenue side. There's an entrance here off of Lancaster that's really a pedestrian entrance, but primarily this is a business that's going to be accessed by employees of this group that are parking primarily in the rear. So there's a rear entrance as well on the back elevation. And the center section is taking its inspiration from the architecture of the existing buildings that are there on either side, with the addition of some glassier, more open and transparent elements as well.
So the idea is this is going to be offices?
Yeah.
Okay.
This is office. This is zoned residential, but this is currently in use as office and has been approved by the zoning board for office.
Okay, great.
They're continuing their use of the site. So these renderings just show the character of what's being proposed here. The existing building to the west already has these finishes. There's a stone base and then a stucco band at the first floor level, and then it switches to a hardy board siding or fiber cement siding, two kinds. We're using a clapboard and a shingle style as it continues up on the different areas of the building. The original building was a masonry construction at the lower level. It had a brick first floor and a shingle style beyond that. So when that building was renovated, it had already been through many, many iterations over the 100 years. So the easiest and best course was to put the veneer stone that matched some of the existing stone, and we've added the stucco over the brickwork that had been repaired and so forth, and then the hardy to emulate the original shingle style. So again, taking that inspiration, we're going to apply those finishes on the rest of the project. And as I say, these newer elements are also punctuated with some of these more glassy, more open, more transparent parts that'll be metal framed windows, storefront glazing with metal frames in a light aluminum finish.
Any comments from the board yet? No, we're good, okay. Maybe we'll just get into a little more detailing.
Okay.
I don't know if you came equipped with a landscaping plan or a lighting plan.
We do. The first plan shows the planting plan. I've got a lighting plan from the landscape architect as well. So this is an analysis showing the candle power on the ground at these proposed locations. This is the typical pole light that will be in the back parking area, and this is showing the illumination that that will cast. The planting plan, I think we showed first, right? We've got the entire landscape architect's design here that includes every species and, you know, all the plantings that will be in place. Essentially, on the Lancaster Avenue side, the streetscape is going to be improved. The current sidewalk there, if you're familiar with the site, is right on the road.
Yeah.
There's almost no curb. It's terrible.
Right.
So this is moving the sidewalk back and creating a green verge there and a new line of street trees and a new hedge. And then this will be sloped upward along the edge. So this will be a walkable area. And they're continuing that same sidewalk improvement down these other buildings, which they also own. So
that's great.
The Emerson Group has been a good partner with the township trying to make some of these improvements happen. So that's on the Lancaster side. You'll see essentially new street trees throughout and repairing that sidewalk. On the back side and nearer to the building, there'll be new foundation plantings, ornamentals and things, and some larger shade trees located in the parking area. And minimal lighting associated with that.
Lighting and landscaping. Any questions? Comments?
No, I think that's okay.
Looks good. Yeah. I like the idea of pulling that sidewalk back. That's just an accident waiting to happen there. Yeah, so that's good.
Yeah, there's some regrading happening as well on these driveway entries because there's very abrupt, and delivery trucks right now park right on Lancaster instead of attempting that. So that's going to be made much more smooth, and they'll be able to circulate through the site.
So. Great. Okay, so we're good with that. Just to backtrack a little bit, the overall look of the project, you guys are okay with that? Materials?
Yeah, I think it looks really nice.
Yeah, I think it looks great.
I like the way that the buildings are going to be integrated into the new design, the existing buildings.
The one building that exists in between these doesn't have a whole lot to recommend it. It's sort of the sideways end of a building, and it doesn't have the same character as these others. So we inherited these bookends of pretty nice manor home style, so we're trying to keep that.
I appreciate that.
Great.
Not everybody does.
Jason, you're okay.
So my question is in reference to the tower element.
Mm-hmm.
So is that going to be open, like sort of, I guess you don't have a section through that at all.
I don't have sections with us here, but essentially we're doing a lot to clean up the site, both on the ground and behind.
Right.
So currently there are fire escapes on a couple of these buildings. Those are going to be removed because we're going to have multiple means of egress throughout here. There'll be three main stair towers through the building. So we're not going to have those exterior stairs. We're removing the exterior Bilco doors that gain access to the basement and the air conditioning condensers that are currently in place in the backside of the property. They're going to be relocated to these balconies on the backside. There's like these sleeping porch elements from the original design. So we'll put some of that equipment there. And the tower offers a place to hide some of those remaining.
So that'll be a clear area with the air handler unit up in?
Up inside the condenser unit will be under that roof in an exterior environment.
Okay.
Below that, it's a stairwell that creates the circulation. The main entry is associated with that.
No, and that's nice. I guess our concern, it's just, you don't want birds nesting up there or whatever else. But if you have the condenser up there, it'll be moving and making too much noise.
Yeah, they'd probably not be happy.
Yeah, all right.
Okay, good. All right, small things like your trash. Where are you gonna have a dumpster as such, or is it going to be self-contained inside? Or
they're currently using bins, and the same owners also own the two adjacent buildings to the west. And so currently the bins are accumulated there behind 407, I believe. And so that's going to continue to be the plan, except the current situation is the trash trucks can't come and get to them, so people are moving them back and forth. So they'll be able to come into the driveway now with the regrading that's happening. And we've already spoken with the Homeowners Association for the folks who live behind and arranged that pickup is going to take place at a reasonable time and so forth. So essentially that's going to be an extension of what's happening now, but it'll be a little bit smoother.
Okay, great.
They don't generate much here, so the idea of a real dumpster
and
the noise associated with that seemed unnecessary.
Sure, great.
What businesses are in there now?
Well, this used to be the Harmonious Spa, and there was a hair salon there, but Emerson has been operating in 407 for 15 years or so, and they've just continued to grow. So it's their own people who are.
So it's planning to be Emerson's.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, they're not renting space or anything. They're
just
growing at a rate that needs to have more places for everybody. So. And they've been working in these discrete buildings and trying to communicate within their company has been difficult to actually get dressed, go outdoors, go talk to somebody. So, you know, the benefit of having a single building is obvious to them.
Oh, that's cool.
So total new square footage is how much? Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm throwing that out there.
I don't remember. The total square footage is about 12,500, which, do you see new? We're adding about 3,000, I think, in square footage. We're reducing the footprint
right
by about 2,000. That's just footprint. The proposed footprint is 5,500, and the existing is 4,700.
Right.
So it's about an 800 square foot difference on the ground, and it's about a 2.5 story building. So.
Right.
Couple thousand square feet.
And you're reclaiming a lot of the, I guess, existing parking lot or asphalt into
turning it
into grass.
Yeah, there's a lot more green on the plan shown than currently exists. The site has multiple driveways that are side by side, and most of those are being removed. We're actually relying on the two extremes here to provide access for the site. So there are three separate driveways that are being removed entirely. And we are creating an organized parking area out of that, but the net is a reduction in impervious and more green space.
Good.
So you spoke about the slope. You're right, because immediately right off the sidewalk, it's a fairly steep slope. It'll mm-hmm. just be a consistent grade change on the way.
Yeah, we're
going to
do that with a lawn. So
yeah.
we'll be flat for that initial verge and the sidewalk, and then there'll be a slope of, you know, 30% or something up the next 5 or 6 feet. The transition there is about 3 feet vertically.
Right.
It has to happen in a short order. So that's just going to be done with a lawn edge, and then there'll be a hedge on the top side of that and street trees along that.
But there's no differential. You're entering, whether you park in the back or the front, you're coming in on the same floor.
Yeah, the circulation is only in one way to the west.
Right.
And that gains access to the other buildings and also to the back parking area, which is the main parking area and the primary entrance for these employees. And if you have to circulate back around, you'd come out either onto Lancaster or along the front of the building where there's
right.
additional parking to be found there. So the primary lot is in the back, and everybody's entering from the same location and exiting from the same location.
Yeah.
Currently, that traffic, you know, you've got everybody in and out, all different directions, and so this should give us some clarity.
It's a nice plan. Of course, a lot of what we do is signage. Are you guys
yes.
going to put some signage up out there?
I think we're going to have to be back. The client is averse right. to signage, to be honest, which is why nobody knows they're there. But
right.
they've been operating there for years, and they don't have a sign. They
okay.
just have their address. We're going to, and this plan does show at least addressing the access.
Right.
So there will be signage at the entry with the address and denoting that that's the entry.
Right.
Trying to distinguish that from this other way, which is our exit, but this is also the entrance for the neighboring business, which is a dental office there. So their
yes.
signage is in place, and that's going to remain, and we're
okay.
not going to have competing signage for them. But the other end, where the entry will be, is going to be identified.
Okay. So we're going to ask the applicant to stop back with
yeah,
a signage package?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, this does just talk about where it would be, but it doesn't.
Sure.
We don't have a design or
okay.
a size or anything.
So we'll
like
ask you
that.
To come back
yeah.
when you feel it's a good time, so. What's your timeline on the project itself?
Well, the renovation has begun on the 413 component. We still have PennDOT approval and a couple of things pending, but most of the hurdles have been gotten through. So we're hoping to begin construction in the summer of the middle
okay.
section.
Great. All right, good. Okay.
Regarding lighting again, just looking at that, do you have anything that's sort of architecturally featured lighting? Other than sort of the light posts?
I don't think that we've designed any. The landscape
yeah.
architect did a landscape plan, and I don't think really considered the building features themselves.
Right.
So I don't think we have any building illumination per se at this point,
right.
and that's something we would consider.
You have some really nice, whether it's the curtain wall or the storefront, right? Like
sure.
there's some opportunity
sure.
to do something that, you know, illuminates that and, you know, shows it off a little bit.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I know that right now there are floodlights and things that don't do anything for
yeah.
anybody, but we'd be removing those, and I think, you know, some uplighting along the stone base or
right.
something would probably mm-hmm. be in order.
Do you have a good rapport with the neighbors behind there?
Now we do, yeah.
You do, good.
We met with them a number of times.
Yeah, good.
There was a snafu with the notifications that went out, and some of those folks didn't get on the list initially from the township. And
okay.
So they were rubbed the wrong way immediately. Right. And so, but we've met with them and their representatives, and over the course of a year and a half now, addressed whatever concerns
Great.
They've voiced to us.
That's important. Yeah. What else, guys?
I mean,
comments, questions?
I mean, I have comments that are more of the architectural nerd side of things, but they're that's a conversation we could have another time.
All right.
Okay.
But
Kevin, anything to add?
I do. Paul, if you could put up the elevation, the rendering. So the tower, which was the topic, and I wasn't sure if you were going to get to this, but I'm concerned about the height. What is the height of that tower? We're at a 35-foot max height to midpoint of a sloped roof. That looks like just visually that you're exceeding that by a lot.
I think it's 42 feet.
Okay.
The main ridge is somewhere approaching that 35-foot limit. We talked to you about this initially, and we decided that this would be the kind of building element that would not be subject to that limit.
We'll have to take another look at that.
Okay.
My understanding is that elevator towers and such don't have to fit within that limit, and that was per conversation with you early on in the planning here. So I'm surprised to hear any consideration of that, but I'm happy to talk to you.
I'm not sure that we saw a rendering of what this was going to be, and again, we can any if the board is going to grant approval, I would just condition it upon resolution of any building height issues.
All right, good.
Okay.
All right.
What is in the tower? Is that elevator there, or is
no? There's a stair tower that provides primary access for the main floors, and then a final access way to the roof surface that has the air conditioning condensers hidden up there. It's just a service thing at the very top.
So it is mostly then aesthetic, not function.
At the peak,
at the top, yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Honestly, one of my goals was to break up this rather long facade and to using these gambrel shapes is one of the methods that we're doing to do that, but to punctuate that with something to give it some relief. Even the building behind, which is just a flat box, has a little pediment at one end to give it some expression here. But
just one other question. I think I know the answer. The large parking lot in the back, will there be signage there or none?
We've got directional signage.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And that's represented on the engineer's plan
okay.
here. So.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's going to park back there unless their employees are.
Yeah, I'm sure
doing
not,
business with Emerson. Okay.
Yeah, there's a park on the opposite side of the street, and when these office hours are over, people do occasionally.
Okay.
But the owner doesn't mind that at all. So.
Okay. All right. What else? That's it. Jason.
No, I'm sorry. I'm going to revisit the issue with regards to the air handling units that you'll have. Mm-hmm. Those in the back. I'm looking at the rear elevation. It's in those balconies that you're placing the other ones.
That's right. In the back elevations, we've got two.
Right. You got one with the trellis over it and the other one where the roof line continues.
That's right.
Over it, right? Those units, so I'm just concerned from the visibility, right? So I'm standing in the parking lot looking up. They're going to be below the height of the sort of the parapet edge or the wall.
We talked to the HVAC contractor about that exactly because some of these have now gotten larger and larger.
Right.
But, we're going to try to select equipment that will be
It'll be
down below
of,
that parapet
right.
wall. Yeah.
Coupled with the complexity of making sure there's enough airflow for it, though, too, right? And it's both issues. Okay.
All right. Any other comments or questions for the board? You're good?
No.
Okay. I don't know who wants to take this.
I'll take it.
You want to take it? Okay.
In the matter of DRB 2019-07, the application of the Emerson Group for a building addition at the location of 409, 411, and 413 East Lancaster Avenue. Move for conditional approval of the application subject to final approval of any height elements. Move to approve that.
Just ask them to come back for signage.
And to come back for signage.
Okay. All right, for a second?
I second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Paul.
We'll look forward to seeing you in future months for the signage.
Thank you.
Okay,
sure.
You bet. Yeah. Next on the agenda tonight is IM Health Walker Family Properties. It's a continuation from our last meeting at 372 West Lancaster Avenue in Wayne for ground sign, wall sign, and an awning, and I'm not too sure if the applicant's here. So at this point, we'll just continue it to the May meeting. Do we have a second on that?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thank you. Next is DRB 2019-16, the application of Spikes, nationally famous. Again, a continuation from last month at 837 Conestoga Road in Bryn Mawr for wall signage.
Good evening, gentlemen. Glenn Hasty from Spikes Trophies.
Hi, Glenn.
How are you?
Good.
All right, so essentially, the sign that we're replacing, the new sign on the left, hasn't changed. There was no issue with that from the previous meeting. And we went with your recommendation for doing just our website on the sign to the right. And I had a conversation before this started. You know, the white kind of makes it look like it's illuminated. It's not. It's not backlit. There are pocket lights above that will, you know, illuminate it at night, but not from behind.
Mm-hmm, good. Okay, so I think that was the major issue last month, if I'm not mistaken, was the graphics.
Right.
Not so much the sign itself. I think we were okay with the overall size. We determined you had to have 25 linear feet in order to get a size at large,
right,
and you met that requirement.
Mm-hmm.
You're with below 15 foot from grade, so you're okay there. And what do you guys think?
No, I think this is good. Good improvement. I think it'll be fairly legible.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, it won't look as jumbled up as the other one. I don't want to tell you as much, but
awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's nice to get the new sign in the neighborhood, so it'll be nice.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think the color actually will probably be a lot more representative of what the original.
Yeah.
Yeah. It'll be muted.
For design intent. Right. Yeah.
Yes.
You're right.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. You guys good?
Yeah, I'm good.
Tim, good?
Yeah.
Glenn, you all right with everything?
Yeah, I'm perfect.
Okay.
Okay, great. Well, then in the matter of DRB 2019-16, the application for signage of Spike's Nationally Famous wall sign application, I move to vote.
Okay. Second. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Thank you, Glenn.
Thank you very
appreciate
much.
Appreciate it. Okay. Next, we have DRB 2019-17, the application of La Cabra Brewing at 810 Glenbrook Avenue in Bryn Mawr for two wall signs and four awnings. And if you guys need a handheld mic, we have it right here also. Okay.
See how we do.
All right.
Hello, I am Dan Popernick, representing La Cabra Brewing as a partner, and this is another partner of the business, Chuck Golder. As you can see, we the existing building that was formerly Biga. We are under construction there and applying for updating of signage with our business.
Mm-hmm.
Also included is awnings to beautify the front and the installation of two roll-up windows. One is over an existing window. The other would be there's an existing normal residential size window, and we're mm-hmm. hoping to install another roll-up there as well.
Okay.
Beautify that side of the building and add airflow.
Okay. Why don't we just look at some of the exterior facade upgrades you plan on doing? Let's take a look at that first.
Okay.
All right. So.
With the exterior, the top plan, you can see there's no change to the existing landscaping or sidewalk there. With the facade, we're going to retain the same paint using the same goosenecks. I included the approval letter for the existing design elements. I included the approval letter there that we'd be using the same goosenecks and illumination.
Okay, so you're not going to paint the building or anything like that, exterior lighting, and keep that the same?
Much to my partner's chagrin, no.
Okay, all right. No. Okay, so that's good. So let's look at the awnings then. You want to put some new awnings in, right?
Yes.
Okay, tell us about those.
These awnings, honestly, we haven't ordered them to finalize the material. but we would be looking for something that, per code, there are materials that are accepted by the township for awnings. I was awaiting approval to do so before ordering them. I realized in the code there was a provision for heavy fabric or something, you know, durable.
Right.
And they would be constructed as that. Also in the code, the height requirement of 7 feet,
mm-hmm.
at the bottom of them, they'd be mounted as such that they'd be above 7 feet. We would comply with code. Also, removed initial plans had along the front, had verbiage along the front panel, which is allowed. However, I removed that.
Okay.
The code was pretty clear that you actually couldn't plate. Like, we were going to have some of the items that we'd be selling in the restaurant. Can't do that.
Right.
So that was removed.
Okay. Yeah, just the name of the business.
Yep.
And you can
look at
a website, phone, or address.
Right.
And that's pretty much it. So, okay. If you decide you want to, you know, you're going to do that, you know, just come back before our
board.
We have
to reapply.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So, I guess the awnings, we would suggest umbrella to the applicant.
I think it'd still be good to see the sort of what selection that is. So the yellow is your brand color, right? Like that's...
At this location, we're
right.
using the yellow as a way of attracting attention.
Okay. So should we give them kind of a free hand on that?
Well,
or
so
make a suggestion?
It's the bodega, and I've heard about this coming for a little while now, so I'm excited about it. One of my buddies was posting on Facebook about it, so I'm excited to see another place coming
thanks.
In here. He's with, I guess it's wrong crowd.
All right, Dan Shaw.
Dan Shaw.
Yeah. Big Dan.
So I saw you guys coming in there, and I was excited to see this. So this is going to be the restaurant component, and there's not going to be Orange Site Brewing, right?
No.
For this restaurant component, so it's a separate kind of, it's not the brewing, it's the restaurant.
It is a tap room.
Okay.
It's a tap room where the beer is still being produced in Berwyn, and we're driving the beer down to be sold in the tap room there for the separate kitchen.
So in terms of the color, because when we're looking at the color, the one thing that the code talks about is you're allowed to use colors that are your business colors.
Okay.
Is this a business color?
Bodega is operating, as La Cabra, there's not a color that is existing in our Berwyn building in Easttown Township. However, Bodega is a separate food concept and a freestanding brand to that extent. So, yes.
Okay.
Okay.
So then, yeah.
All right, good. All right, why don't we look at the signage, and we'll look at the one on the front of the building first.
Can I just ask
sure.
before, while we're on the topic of the canopies, before we move off, how far, or what's at least sort of estimated for how far they're going to project from the face of the building, right? I know that's, you know, there's nothing here that sort of conclusively determines what that is, right? Are we coming?
I would say approximately 2.5 feet.
So only like 30 inches.
It's the front of the building, really. The existing Biga elevation shows that you really wouldn't want to come off the building too far.
Right.
It would look ugly.
It's a little narrow toward the
yeah.
side.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
it's, okay.
And again, they haven't been ordered. They
mm-hmm.
haven't been ordered because I was awaiting
sure.
approval.
Sure. I mean,
yeah, that's fine. I guess my next question before we get on the signage then is, and you guys can stop me if I'm jumping ahead. But is sort of how we're looking at that door on the far left. So in Biga's, you know, in there, when they had that restaurant, that was their entrance door, right? So you guys are looking to close it off, but it's a non-operable door based on the plan, right? Because you have seating. Where did I just put the plan?
We will not be closing off any doorways. However, the flow of the business, it will be moved
to the center door there.
To the far right door.
Oh, okay.
We'll be encouraging guests to come in that doorway. Sean, one of the former owners of Biga, had a thing for odd entrances, and we don't. More logical entrances towards the right of the building. We would not be rendering any doors inoperable. However, that left door would remain locked and encourage people to enter through the right.
The reason why I guess I bring that up a little bit is for consistency's sake. And I'm walking the fence here. It could go either way. And what I mean by that is, so just looking at the elevation right now, you could argue it's hard to determine which door to go in, right? You'll have signage or it'll be something up, but that I don't deny. But would there be a reason to render that door in the same finish as you have the other two doors on that facade and extend the canopy over that door as well? Right, so now you have louvers over that. I'm looking at the existing commissions.
It would be floating in space. If that's a suggestion from you, I wouldn't be opposed to discussing that. By code, if it's an aesthetic value, I'd be happy to discuss that.
It is an aesthetic issue. I'm just, it's not anything that we're not documenting.
Mr. Chairman, before we get too far down the conversation of awnings, a few items, and I know, and it's represented in that upper right photo, the building's very close to the street frontage and the right-of-way, and we couldn't permit awnings to extend into the right-of-way. Mm-hmm. So we have to be mindful of where the property boundaries are, setbacks and things like that, because this would be attached to the structure. There's very strict limitations as to what could extend outside of the principal building setback. So a lot
going over that doorway might actually take us.
Any of the awnings? Yeah, okay. So we need to take a look at that a little bit closer. Hmm. Again, we're going to need specifics as to projection off of the building.
Face of the building.
And something else that we ran into, and I don't know that it's a huge issue here, but further down, we had some awnings that were put in, and it ended up impacting the solar kiosks for the parking. So we just need to be mindful if that's something that you're going to authorize and approve. That there's some coordination with the parking authority on any kiosks, any potential impacts to those as well.
Okay. Maybe it'd be wise to ask the two gentlemen here to stop back next month.
The projection off the facade is going to be the important one. And what I would argue for based on that is whatever is for consistency's sake is that whatever you get on the corner, right, that you're whether or not you project over that existing door or not, we're speaking about aesthetics, not, what's permitted. But if you were to start at that edge, right, the far left edge of the elevation along Conestoga, right? No. Yeah. Not Conestoga.
Haverford Avenue,
basically.
County line.
Sorry. At that point, it would be County Line.
So if you, County Line and Bryn Mawr Avenue, starting at that corner, so that left, whatever you're permitted to project off, right, per Kevin's comment earlier, right, that's what, if you can't make it 30 inches, it ends up only being 12. And for consistency's sake, I would argue that that should be 12 then for the remaining two as well.
So if the awning, regardless of the position and this in relation to the setback, that they would be a consistent length off the building?
Correct.
Okay.
So that whatever's, whatever is on the far left is what dictates the projection for the other two canopies as well. And then the third one on the other side. There's a third one on the other side, right? Yeah.
Okay.
And the other thing is that I'm just trying to find it. Somewhere in the book, awnings can't be illuminated. Right. And you've got a lot of spots in that building. So I don't know how we're going to work that, if they'll go above those spots or.
Well, you would argue where the spots are. Like here. They're all going to be sort of underneath.
Underneath then, okay.
Right.
All right. Okay. Yeah, so it should sit a little higher than that. Okay, why don't you come up with a plan, and we'll ask you to stop back next month if that's convenient for you.
Okay. Is there a comment on with the signage as far as the square footage?
We're going to look at that.
Yeah.
That's coming next.
Awnings need to come back. Okay.
While we're on the subject of the lighting, do you have any intent to continue to use the existing lights that are actually on the building right now?
Yes, we would be using the existing illumination.
Okay.
You're talking about that one there, Tim?
There's two.
Just looking at them all.
Looking at all of them, okay.
Two goosenecks on the main sign and one gooseneck on the corner sign. Black innocuous goosenecks.
And the other spots, like some of those are going to actually be, there's some coordination issues, right? Some of them will be under the canopy. Right, I'm looking at like the center door and then the one to the right, like just looking at the existing photographs. They actually exist under the canopy. Right, the single spots, you can see the conduit running.
Yep, those would be under the canopy for this design.
I'm just going to make a suggestion, and we're not here to design your building or anything that, but your main entrance is going to be the door to the right?
Correct, yes.
I mean, so you see, like some restaurants and some businesses where it's almost like an oval awning over top the point of entrance. Mm-hmm. They kind of just, to tell you exactly where to enter. And possibly maybe you want to do something like that, and maybe just in the 8-inch letters or smaller, put your name of the business on there.
Above the...
Because there's a lot going on with three doors, and just maybe then some confusion.
The logo is orange as well, right?
Yeah, as long as they're 8 inches or...
Right, so you do have your logo, you can put that there as well with that. And you might want to just do with the one awning, especially since you're going to have the sign in the center of the building, where the entrance is going to be on the other side, kind of guiding people to the correct entrance if there's the awning over there, which also you're away from the corner with the intersection with Bryn Mawr Avenue, which means you may have more availability for an awning there before you get into the right-of-way issue.
Frankly, I'm not much of an aesthetic person, but after hearing comments and discussions of setbacks, it actually might make more sense to just put an awning only over the, an awning like you've indicated over the entrance door.
Right, let it go like that.
With setbacks, knowing that and thinking of it, I'm doubtful that that would actually comply to code.
Okay.
Because like Bob was saying, like, once you see that awning over a door, you know that's the door you're going in.
Right.
Sure. Which, when you have three doors, simplifies the whole thing.
Right.
Okay, well, I should have stopped back on that subject for next month or whenever it's convenient for you guys.
And
so
I'll get off the canopies for
go ahead.
Right after this. But sort of in the design of that, right? So there's nothing here that's conclusive to tell us this. And so, what the next thing is, right? It could be a single plane, right? It's just sort of off the facade of the building. So I sketched, right? And I'm not designing this for you. It's either a single plane or is there a little fascia panel where you see like the flat edge that's perpendicular to the sidewalk as well, right? In the design of that canopy, for where you could put signage or something else on that little 8-inch piece that's there. And I think that's the next level of design that you guys need to kind of take into consideration for what that canopy really looks like. It arguably is it all the windows or just that one, that's fine. But I think we need to know a little bit more about the sort of the design and sort of the assembly of that canopy. A little bit more helps us understand it better.
With the way that building faces, it's not like you're using the awnings either for
awnings
the
aren't
sun.
Doing anything for sun.
Because the sun's on the backside of the building.
It's really a branding, almost, it's an extension of your signage and your brand. So.
Okay. All right, good. All right. So
now we can get into signs.
Let's look at signs. All right, why don't we look at the front sign first?
Okay.
Tell us what you have going on there.
This would be using the dimensions for the existing sign, changing to indicate the name of our business on the main sign.
Okay. So what type of material are you going to use on that?
More than likely either a sturdy industrial plastic or a laminated wood.
Okay, so you got goosenecks coming off of that or onto that.
Yes. Another reason another reason to use the existing lighting. It's there.
What do you guys feel about that?
The rendering shows it in red. You're not painting that, or are you going to paint the existing goosenecks?
No, we would not.
It's going to be what's on the photograph.
I was trying to show, indicate, things that would be points of discussion.
Mm-hmm.
That's totally fine.
Okay. Certainly the letter size is less than what the previous restaurant had in there, so.
Yeah. And it incorporates the logo and the O. I like that. It's
simplified, but get the point across.
Yeah.
That's sort of the idea there.
Okay, you guys okay with that?
I like the sign.
Okay.
I think it's good.
Okay.
In going to the next one, sign on the other side?
Well, just to, before we go there, just make sure your installer hides the fasteners. You don't want to see big bolts through the front of that. And there's a way that they can do that. So just make sure it's a nice, clean install. All right, and that front sign is 32 square feet.
Yes, sir.
So we need to keep you at 50 feet or below. So let's see what you have on the other side. And I think you might be over just a little bit, so you might have to shave down one of those signs just a bit.
Yeah, I do have, in the packet, I included calculations.
Okay.
Based on linear frontage.
Mm-hmm.
And with the proposed signing and in the side sign, we're still below compliance.
Basically. Okay, good. All right, so we're good with the front sign, right?
Yeah.
Okay, let's look at that side sign.
I mean, construction-wise, in the assembly, it's the same thing, right? Yep. Whether it's, right, we're looking at that.
Okay. All right, good.
Same location.
Okay. Just use a mic.
Sorry.
Okay.
It's the same location, similar to the front. We're just sort of replacing with our own,
gotcha.
Brand.
Okay. All right, so what are your, what's your size on the front and the side? What did you come up with square footage-wise? I think the front was 32.
Yes, front is 32, and the square footage on the side sign is 22.25. I squared off the calculation because I did not take calculus, and I cannot find the area under a curve.
So it looks like you're a little over. You're allowed 50 max?
No, with 53.3 linear feet of footage, I have the calculations here for both the first 15 feet, what's allowed for there, then every foot, linear foot after that. Our total available signage for the building, and that's actually excluding, I excluded the opportunity for linear footage on the other side. I even excluded, right. Excluding that, we're allowed, there's an allowance for 70.3 square feet, and we're only applying to use 54. 0.25 square feet of that. We have 16 square feet left over.
Okay, we just got Tim take a look at that real quick. Okay. So, yeah. So the, just to go back to the awning for a second, you have an awning on the side of the building?
Yes.
You'll reconsider that also?
Yes.
When you come back, okay.
So you are installing a new window on that facade, on the Bryn Mawr Avenue one, right?
With the matter of the two roll-up windows, the idea was to install a new window and to install a new awning. Which, speaking on behalf of the partners, if that would not be a reason, if that were a hang-up, mm-hmm. That would not be a reason that we would, not walk away happily able to open with a sign and.
Okay, Tim's kind of checking out that square footage question. How do you feel with that? I mean, we're close. We're just,
right.
Fighting over a couple square feet. So, but
do you guys have that last?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're looking at that
here. But, let's, while Tim's doing that, and I think we're going to have to ask Kevin this question. Kevin, the roll-up windows.
There's a couple issues that come with that with the food establishment. Obviously, the separation from the food prep area. Our health officers will have to take a look at that to make sure that there's no health code, food code issues mm-hmm. with that. And then the second issue of concern is noise.
Right.
Those are gonna be open. There's not a heavy presence of residential uses down there other than those right above. But it's also right on the border with Lower Marion Township. So you just have to be mindful if they are open and there's a lot of noise being generated, and the police respond, it could create some issues that you have rather expensive element to your facade that you aren't able to use. So I'll have to make sure that you guys do the due diligence from the food code issues and just be mindful of the noise issues.
Thank you.
So Kevin, you'll work with the applicants on that, or is that kind of out of our hands? Or
I'll bring it to the attention of our health officials, but they should also go through their design professional to make sure that as they're designing the interior of this facility, that they're taking that into consideration. There's ways of separating those areas so that you can have kind of an opening like that. I don't know, are going to be screen protected? Or are they going to be, what is the ultimate design? I'm not seeing a whole lot of detail as to the roll-up windows.
While open, there are screens that can be placed in. It's basically, you use it for, is it for RVs or?
Yeah, RVs, big garage doors that have a screen across the front of them. So.
And your intent is to then have them screened while they're open?
Yeah, that would be pending, would be the health department's comments on it.
Okay. It's probably gonna address the concern with the health food regulations. You'll still have the noise issues to possibly contend with.
What would be our pathway as far as considerations of noise and thinking, with the intersection, the busy five-way intersection there, across the street is the hospital, and bordering, I guess it would be in Lower Marion, is the Wawa. What path would you see? Where should I proceed?
The Wawa's still in Radnor, but ultimately, noise is enforced by our police department, and it's primarily complaint-driven. There are noise hours for construction, but again, if it's something later at night, and the police are called out, they're responding to a complaint, they assess it at that time.
Okay.
I'm going back to the awnings for a second, and back to the awnings.
All right.
And Kevin kind of jogged my memory a little bit. I think within the last year, we had two applicants that came in, and I think Ray sat on both of those applicants, where at both the new cabinet store on Route 30 and Conestoga Road and Snap Kitchen, both wanted yellow signs. And Ray felt it might be a hazard as people are coming up to a busy intersection with traffic signals, that you see yellow and it kind of throws you off on the traffic signals. And I don't know, Kevin, it's a township issue, I assume, a little bit, or what do you feel about that?
I understand the concept of what the concern possibly could have been.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, we don't regulate colors in that term.
Mm-hmm.
From a zoning standpoint,
right.
If that's something that was concerned with DRB, then that, yes.
Yeah.
Just cabinets, I think it's just cabinets. They have the cabinet place, solid wood cabinets, rather.
Right.
They have yellow primarily in a lot of their signage and window coverings and things like that.
Yeah.
So,
We had them put the ground sign as almost a cream color,
yeah,
and not the yellow.
Yeah, I remember that.
And then Snap Kitchen, if I remember right, I think they wanted to paint their pole yellow, and Ray says no, and I think they went with the gray color.
I remember the cabinets. I don't remember Snap, but
yeah,
Snap still
I think
has
it's
a
Snap
yellow.
Might have been before your time, possibly. Was it? Okay. But I remember the color.
Yeah.
Ray made that comment.
Yeah, and I can see the ground sign over at the cabinet place because it's right on the corner.
Yeah.
If this is mounted up high on the
mm-hmm.
building.
Okay.
The approach, it's not like you're driving into the yellow. It's
okay.
More on the side.
All right. Okay. Just something to consider.
Well, I mean, if you look at the existing photograph, you could argue the what used to be the thrift shop next door
mm-hmm.
has yellow wood trim. It's
okay.
painted yellow
right.
already. Right.
I mean, the yellow is bright, and that's, I think, the reason that it was picked. I know with the cabinets, we definitely did
mm-hmm.
push back on them on the yellow.
Right.
You're coming back to us if between now and then you decide that a different color other than yellow is something that you would like. I think that's something we would favorably look upon. The yellow is very bright, but I think with the location, trying to draw focus to it, I think also with it playing off of a gray building,
mm-hmm.
I see why the yellow would be used. So that's
okay.
Would it benefit? I mean, this is for design intent, right? Like it
right.
may not be this bright yellow. And so what we do see in front of us is material samples as well. That'll be brought in sometimes for different projects.
In the cover letter, I had a call number for the Sherwin-Williams, the call number for that, and it was decisive yellow.
Okay.
That was for the sign or for the, that's for the sign because the fabric, the canopy.
Awning, the color of the awning would be dependent on the fabric that
okay.
the manufacturer can get.
Yeah,
no, I don't believe that they, it would look exactly like it was printed here.
Right.
And based on these comments and taking them back to my partners for discussion, I could also foresee, frankly, just to be straight, I could foresee us removing the awnings if it is going to be,
mm-hmm.
If it's going to be an issue or if there are going to be more,
right.
several issues with setbacks. The more likely scenario is I bring this feedback back to my partners
mm-hmm.
and we do not submit for them.
Well, again, maybe just over the front door.
Location.
By no means are we opposed to them. We're just fleshing them out a little bit more. That's
okay.
all.
All right. Tim, did you have any luck on that?
When I read this, my reading of it is that the first 50 feet, the first 15 feet allows you to 2 square feet, then you get 1 square foot for every additional 2 feet, right?
Yeah.
That's correct.
So, but that's also when a building has frontage on more than one street,
mm-hmm.
as this does,
right.
the sign area is limited for each side based
right.
on the frontage of
mm-hmm.
that side.
Okay.
So I'd say that the bodega sign being 32 square feet
mm-hmm.
on the front fits for that side.
Right.
The question that we don't have enough information before us is the amount of frontage of the building on Bryn Mawr Avenue in order to determine whether the side sign.
On the sign area calculations, I did have, by our understanding, we are not able to include the linear 28 feet linear on the side of the building. That was not included in our calculations. We're well below Even just taking the front, what our front frontage allows us, both signs included are below that allowance. I just, in the one, the calculations memo, I did not include in our need or our proposed need for square footage, I didn't even include the side, which is 28 square feet.
All right, look, 28 gives
Sorry,
you
28 linear, 28 linear feet.
28 would give you. 28. Yeah, it gives you.
That'd be
30. Yeah.
Okay. So I'm, if it's 28, if you're saying it's 28 on that side, I'm fine with that.
Okay. Right. All right, good. All right. So same thing, just make sure your installer does a good job. Line fasteners and all that stuff, so.
Yeah, I mean, just by the first 15 feet principle, that alone would be 30, right. 30 square feet,
yeah.
And that sign is below that
right.
as well.
Right, okay. All right. All right, you're limited on your window signage. I don't know if you're ready. You can only put up to 20% window signage. Okay, so don't litter it all up.
hours of operation.
Yeah, yeah, well, that's fine. Yeah. Your address number, you're going to need to have that somewhere prominently displayed on the building. Okay. I'm not too sure Biga had it. Did we see it anywhere?
That yeah. is not on there.
Okay.
As far as a
right
need for posting
you.
In the window,
I see it. Okay.
They have, and frankly, that's something that I could foresee moving to the new entrance. So
right.
The actual,
okay.
I'd be happy to do that.
Just in case it gets noisy, and the police have to pay a visit. You know, don't want to see that. You know.
we'll be sure to put it in the right door. Yeah.
Close those windows real quick. Yeah, all right.
Thrift shop.
Okay. All right, and. I mean, just out of curiosity, do you plan on having music in there, live music or anything? Is that
space isn't really conducive for that? I'm sorry.
Yeah. You're the music expert.
Sure. Sure. Yeah, the space doesn't really lend itself all that well to a stage area or anything.
Okay.
It's not in the direct plan as of right now. So.
Okay, good. And what are we talking about?
Oh, right. Well, I'm still kind of want to come back to the new window on the Brumar side, right? So, like, the other ones make sense, right? The roll-up occurs within, you're just retrofitting that within the existing, you know, window opening that you have. But with regards to the Bryn Mawr one, that's a total, you know, pull that window out and sort of demolishing a good chunk of the wall there, right? So, you know, from a consistency point, you know, is it the same size? The mounting height looks as if it's going to be a little bit taller, right, than what the other one is.
I have eight. They would 8x5. They both do the same frame.
Same frame size
window.
For that one.
Yeah.
What's your thought there, Jason?
No, I just want to make sure that.
Oh,
we're
okay.
I mean, that's, you know, I'm just saying, like, this is mm-hmm. blown open
right.
or something. Like, you'd see it like.
Mm-hmm. I think the natural break in the visual, the light, you know, lines of sight, you can't see both sides really at the same time. So being on opposite ends of the
right.
building, I don't think we're looking at it on paper here, but in reality, you're not going to see, you know, both at the exact same time.
Okay.
Unless if you're standing in the middle of the intersection, but then you have bigger
and
problems.
You're in big
right.
trouble.
Yeah. Okay. All right, good.
That's okay. So, you know, we just have some... Regarding signage, the other thing are sandwich boards, right? The little triangle teepee ones that occur outside on the sidewalk.
I understand those are a no-no.
Those are absolutely not.
Yeah.
We will not purchase any sandwich signs.
So, and then window signage, we know 20% is what you're allowed.
You heard that, right?
I promise.
And then address number on there, on the, you know, so hours of operation, but also maybe
on
in white
glass.
Vinyl, whatever.
On the glass, okay.
You're
sure.
putting the street number on there.
Okay.
So. Okay, good.
All right.
Other comments, question? Tim, you're good?
I'm good, and I wish you guys the best of luck.
Yeah, really.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
I'm looking forward to it, like I said.
Yeah. I know it may, you know, we're just asking questions, but this process is to be, you know, we're here for the benefit of you guys.
It's a tough location.
Yeah.
It is a tough location historically, so I wish you guys the best of luck with it.
We'll see how we can do. With the question of the awnings, if I were to take your comments back and if we were to decide that we wanted to modify that plan, resubmit, I understand that the specs for how far projection of the building, exact materials, color sample of the actual material,
yeah.
I would need to submit them. Mm-hmm. If we were to remove that part of our application, how would I notify you? This first time in Radnor Township.
Notify Peggy.
Make a resubmission, and we get you on the next available board meeting.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Mr. Chairman, just one other thing.
Yes.
Jason mentioned about the sandwich board signs. It's any portable signs, so yard signs, those wavy flags that stick in the ground, anything that is not a permanent mounted sign is illegal.
Wavy arm guy.
Those are not allowed.
Yeah, that's, the code is pretty clear about that. It's my job to read the code.
Okay, if you're going to stop back to see us next month, you're going to have to get your corrected awning package into Peggy by April 17th to get on next month's agenda. All right. So, okay, who wants your turn, Tim?
So I guess at this point we are approving the signs, but not the awnings, and we're approving the windows.
Well, I guess.
Conditionally.
Conditionally. Yeah, okay.
All right.
Fire away.
In the matter of DRB 2019-17, the application of La Cabra Brewing Company, or Brewing LLC, for the installation of wall signs, awnings, and the approval of windows at the location at 810 Glenbrook Avenue. Bryn Mawr, move for conditional approval subject to health code, health review.
Okay, good. Do we have a second?
I second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, and you guys are all right with everything? Any other questions?
No, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, bud. Okay. Next is DRB 2019-18, the application of Urban Neon Incorporated for Razor Bar at 201 East Lancaster Avenue in Wayne for two wall signs and window signage. Gentlemen, need to use a handheld? Okay. Good. You're on.
Okay. I'm Richard Libertour.
Okay, nice and loud, too.
I'm Richard Libertour from Urban Neon, and this is Evan Urbani from Urban Neon, and this is Ed Tell from Razor Bar.
Nice. Nice to have you here. Okay, so I think everybody's familiar with the location of this.
You want to ask if Razor Bar wants to introduce themselves?
Yeah, we'll do it, and then we'll finish it up at the end. Yeah. So, okay. So it looks like you're going to do some signage. You have a corner property you're allowed. Signage on each side of the street because it's a corner. So why don't you tell us what you have there?
We have two non-illuminated building signs, one facing Lancaster Avenue and the other one facing Luella Drive. And then we have two illuminated window signs hanging cabinets for each window on each elevation.
And those are hanging from the inside.
Okay. All right. So why don't we look at the ones mounted on the wall first?
Okay.
Dimensions and heights and everything like that we need to look at.
So each elevation, they're both exactly the same sizes. They're 25 inches by 84 inches. The square footage for them is 14.58 square feet.
Mm-hmm. Okay, which is fine. So the material you're gonna use on that?
It'll be a PVC backer board with PVC letters, and the accent boards are also PVC. It'll be a half inch PVC background, and the letters will be three quarter inches thick.
So it'll have a little dimension.
Yes.
Okay. What do you guys?
No, I think that's good.
Okay. Nice. Tim.
I like it.
Okay. So they are non-illuminated, correct?
Correct. Yes.
Okay. So you'll get some lighting just from street lighting?
There are existing up lighting on the storefront. But the side does not have anything existing. And
okay.
I don't think Eddie is planning on putting anything there.
Okay. Okay.
On the storefront, on the front elevation. Okay.
All right, so you guys are good with that? Okay, size?
Yeah, I think size is fine. As long as so it's 25 inches for the total height of the sign?
Correct, yes.
The question is the letters themselves?
The letters are, I believe, a little over 9 inches.
Okay. Because we permit
close to 10, 9.8 inches.
Oh, there it is. I'm sorry, I didn't. Yeah.
No, I think it's, that's a nice clean
especially sign. Because it's sitting back off of the main road there.
Mm-hmm. That looks good. Okay, so it's a duplicate basically on the other side.
Yes.
Same thing. And height from grade, hopefully you're under the 15 feet from grade. It looks like you're 12.6 or maybe even a little under.
Yeah. So you're fine.
You're fine there too. So you're good on your height, materials, size, lighting, height. What else about the wall signs?
I'm saying.
I think it looked pretty.
I think it looks really nice.
Looked pretty good.
It's clean. Yeah. It looks okay. Nice.
Okay. So it looks like you're going to put a barber pole out there also.
Correct.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Yes, would like to.
Okay, good. Good. And I'm sure we have no objection to a barber pole.
Well, I believe this may be in the WBOD, and there's sign height regulations for projecting signs.
You want to look at that as
so,
a projecting sign?
Yeah, we need it's to be very careful about how far it's projecting off, at what height, because we wouldn't want somebody particularly walking around that corner and walking into something and hitting their head. So I think we're going to treat that as we would a sign. It's in essence a sign for a barbershop. So just be mindful of that. Because there's no details.
I think the problem we may find, Kevin, is that these projecting signs, here we go right here, they don't allow for anything that high. I'm not sure what your normal barber pole is height-wise, but.
Well, I guess the question would be if this thing, one of two things, does it fall under signage or does it become an architectural feature? Right, at which case, I don't know how to sort of interpret this, but even if it falls under an architectural feature, you're going to be required to essentially imagine a blind person with a cane, right? You're going to need an element underneath that allows their cane to know that they're hitting something that their head could run into. So you'd have to be, if it's an architectural feature, there would have to be something below at the sidewalk level, a guardrail that comes up 3 to 6 inches that, like I said, could be hit by a cane. To inform people that there's a projection.
I guess
it's how we interpret that as signage or as we interpret that as an architectural feature.
Right.
I know this is kind of a little bit of an anomaly in that case.
I guess one way around it, and it's kind of a weird way, is actually to have it inside the store. And then we'll look at it as window signage, and it'll fall within the 20%.
Well, the other thing, too, is it could be
the left side there, like that. Side of the letter cabinet in there, like on the inside?
I mean, pause. I'm just drawing that out as maybe. I think it's certainly an identifiable item for a barbershop to have the pole.
Right.
So
yeah, there's probably no one of the most recognized marks there.
Exactly. It's like the golden arches. Everybody knows it. But Tim, what are you seeing on that as far as language for something like that?
I don't think there is. So that there's something that stuck in my mind. There might be something on that, but that I can't find it.
All right, we'll give you a minute.
Yeah, you don't know of any exception for barber poles or anything like
no,
that?
No, and I would treat that as a sign. First, in the WBOD, it's minimum of 9, maximum of 12 feet in the height for a projecting sign. And then under the definitions for signs, you have any writing, figure, representation, logo, emblem, flag, lighting, banner, device, and I think that kind of, it's device. Drawing attention, it's representative of, so I would treat that as a sign.
Okay.
A projecting sign in the WBOD. So it would have to meet those parameters, 153.15.
Okay. All right, well, while Jason's looking it over also, why don't we just jump ahead just a little bit. We'll look at that window signage that you have. And make sure that fits in with our code. So you've got a window signage in the front, and I believe you want to put one on the side to match, correct?
Correct, they're identical.
Okay.
30 inch by 30 inches.
Okay.
Total square foot, mm-hmm. feet, it's 6.25 mm-hmm. square feet.
And you certainly have quite a bit of window space there, and if we do the calculations, hopefully it meets 20% or under. Did you do the calculations?
Okay. I did not do the calculations on it.
Okay.
So.
All right. The sign is...
6 1/4?
Yeah, 6 1/4 square feet. So,
what's the window?
The window is
74 by 84, 74 and a half by 84 and a half. And then multiply that times 2.
Yeah.
And then subtract the...
Yeah. I got to believe it fits, just looking at it, but...
I went to law school, so I don't do math, so...
It's on you, Jason.
All right, let's quickly do the math. All right, so that's 84, 25 times 74.5. Oh, wait, crap, 74.5.
It's tough when the pressure's on.
Yeah. Well, big sausage fingers are what's getting in the way. All right. So that's, let's call that 6295 square inches, right? And then the sign is 30 by 30. Equals 900 divided by...
Eddie, when do you plan on opening up? When do you plan on opening up?
We're hoping before Memorial Day, like the week of May 20th.
Okay, good. So good.
There's, you know, some few boxes to check, but
okay,
that's our latest best estimate.
Good, good.
So you're at 14.3% for the front, but the back, the side windows are different, right? So that's 84.5 times 57 equals times 2. Wait, no, you're fine. You're fine.
Okay.
Yeah,
it's fine for both.
It's actually 7%. I didn't double it.
They're bigger.
7% in the front, and then this one is, you're fine.
Okay, all right. Great. All right, so window signage is fine. Wall signage is fine. Barber pole is a little bit of an issue. And
what do you recommend? Do you want to just do the barber pole at a later point? I move forward with the...
So I think as reading and as Kevin, you know, noted, anything under 9, the barber pole has to be at 9 feet to the bottom of it from the sidewalk level, at which case, is it really worth it? Right? Like now it's a little too high, you know, to Bob's point, inside could kind of be cool and becomes a feature. I don't know what jurisdiction or how we could get into it if it went inside the vestibule area. And what I mean by that is if you look at where did I just have it? Right, the images, you see how that entrance is shared by 3 doors, right? To go upstairs, you guys on the left and the other tenant on the right. I don't know if it can occur within the property line of the sidewalk step that goes up.
It would still be a sign, so even if in that vestibule.
Still, if it still calculates per signage for that, then we're still, you still
I'd
at 9 feet, then that
doesn't
work.
If you want to have the pole outside, then it needs to be raised up.
Raised up, sure.
Which if you wanted to raise it up, you could even maybe put it on the corner, so that it's seen on both sides. Clearly,
right,
the side
on the Luella corner, right? On
So that corner, then you can see it from both sides, and I think at that point, then it gets more visibility, possibly.
It could almost be even with the primary sign out there, right? Like up that high, right?
That it would be, right? Because you're at 9 feet above to the bottom, above the grade, and then the top of it, roughly, I mean, we're just kind of eyeballing it, but it would be in alignment with the sort of top edge of that.
But basically, you're limited to a 3-foot barber pole or less. Can't go any higher than 12 feet, and it's got to be at least 9, so that,
will that
the box is meant
to be illuminated.
Yes.
They can, yes.
Yeah, it would be illuminated.
I asked the question.
Because it's moving and it can't. It's a moving light.
It can't move and it can't be illuminated.
Yeah.
All right. How about inside window on the front?
Even if it's inside, Kevin, it's probably not on.
Well, if it's inside, I think that's a different conversation.
But can it be rotating and?
Can it's inside. Then.
It's kind of a.
Inside, I'm not considering it a sign. I'm considering it an architectural element of the store. Inside it would be okay.
Yeah. So basically, you could put a barber pole outside as long as it's not illuminated or moving, and provided it fits in no lower than 9 feet, no higher than 12 feet from grade,
that,
3
right.
feet pole,
so we'll probably
stationary pole.
Free outside.
Yeah, that's. I'd rather just take it off the table for outside.
The bang for your buck is
there. You go.
Yeah, it's
okay.
It's nice to have. It's not mission critical for
right.
success.
Okay. All right. Okay. Good.
So what is your barbershop and
yes.
also
luxury barbershop?
Okay.
Might as well get your 30-second commercial in.
Men's salon. High-end luxury men's salon. Mm-hmm. We are our first location. We're up in Providence Town Center.
Collegeville.
Where Movie Tavern is and the Brandolini property up there. This will be our second location.
It's great.
Yeah.
So you do shaving great. And
yep.
haircut?
Haircuts and shaves are our primary thing.
Okay.
Yep.
How many operators? Quite a few.
We'll up in Collegeville, I have 12.
Wow.
But we'll have, this will have four stations.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll probably have four stations, but six barbers rotating.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's good. Right. Good luck to you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
It's a good time of year to open up a barbershop.
Yeah. Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, it's great business. Great connection with the community and our clients that come in and the connection they have with their stylists or barbers, it amazes me. Yeah.
Right, right. I went on your website, actually. You guys are a little bit more than a barbershop, too, right?
A little bit. Yeah. A little bit.
So it's kind of a deluxe.
There you go.
It's almost like a spa treatment in there, right?
In some ways. Our tagline is a cool experience.
All right, cool.
So, yeah, there's some services in Collegeville. We do nails and services up there. We're streamlining that for the Wayne location.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll be focused on haircuts and shaves.
Great. Yeah. Good. Lots of luck. Okay, so how are we looking here? We're in pretty good shape here.
So I think it's good. Other than, again, you've heard us say no sandwich boards or temporary signage outside.
I completely agree with you on that.
Window, we already figured out the calculations of the window. Minus just putting the address on there.
Do you want to?
Yes. Oh, hours and
hours of operation.
It's
you're based on the math that we did. You're well under the 20 feet with the your 30 by 30 sign.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good. Any other questions for the board? You guys are okay.
Yeah, we're good.
Okay. I guess is it your turn?
Yeah. Okay. All right. In the matter of DRB 2019-18, the application by Razor Bar via Urban Neon Inc. for signage at 201 East Lancaster Avenue. I move to vote and approve.
Second. We'd say we're taking off.
We're conditional. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
No longer the
barber pole.
Barber pole has been removed from the application at this point.
Correct.
So subject to the removal of the barber pole.
Yes.
Okay. Good.
I would second that motion.
Okay. Great. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
Good luck, Eddie.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Good. Thanks, Tim.
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, you bet.
Best luck.
Next is DRB 2019-19, the application of Kids Clubhouse of the Main Line at 150 North Rodner Chester Road, Suite F-130 in Wayne for window signage and an awning. Another awning. Yeah.
We'll be here all night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hello there.
I prepared a revised version of the...
Sure, come on up. Yeah.
It has changed since then, but only this page.
That's fine.
So I'd rather give you only one page.
No problem.
The whole package.
Thank you.
That's fine. Thank you very much.
Okay, so just let us know who you are and...
So, Christian Boulanger, I'm the owner of Signs de la Corte in Westchester.
Okay.
For a kids club house on this project.
Mm-hmm.
And we've two different sides of the project. One is an awning at the entrance of the building.
Okay, just try. I'm sorry, sir. Just try to talk into the mic, or I have a handheld here for you. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
And there's a bit of it here. And window graphic along the on all the windows.
Okay.
I don't know if you want to talk about the window graphic first or the...
Let's do the awning first.
Okay, so on the awnings will be on the same spot that where there was an awning before. So we're going to just cover the same space.
Mm-hmm.
The awning will be lighted, but top down, just for the people waiting. The kids' clubhouse, I don't know, it's like a la carte mm-hmm. kind of a... kids, you can leave your kids for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours if you want to go to the movie and whatever.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So the door will be locked at all time mm-hmm. From the outside, and people may wait there.
Right.
So that's why they want to have an awning to protect against the rain and
sure.
the light for this to be lighted during the winter.
Okay.
The light will go just through the building, and we're going to reuse what was the holes that was done before. It's just nothing mm-hmm. special. Just the anchor would be different because we're not going to anchor in the same place.
Okay.
It's not safe.
What type of material are you going to use?
The material would be an aluminum frame, and the fabric that's going to be used would be the sunbrella.
Right. Okay. Good.
Sunbrella fabric. Mm-hmm. We just put a green here, which is about the green that's going to be used, and on that.
Okay, so you're going to have some lettering on the front, just on the face of the awning, correct?
Just the face would be just the name, Kids Clubhouse. Mm-hmm. Pretty simple, nothing special. And we put the F-130 on the window, on the door, which is the address of the place in the building, in the corner building.
So do you have the size of the letters?
There was the height is 12 inches, so the letters will be like 6 inches.
Okay, as long as the largest letters are not more than 8 inches.
They won't be.
Yeah, okay.
And they can't be.
Right.
Okay. There's not enough space for that.
Okay, good. All right. Okay, we okay with the awnings and comments?
Is there a side to the awnings, or is it just the top and then the small fascia in the front?
There's side.
There are sides that go back.
Yes.
Okay.
It's really the... You know, we can't see that here, but you see on the graphic you have on the first page of the document.
Yeah, you can see this is
the side.
The middle
yes.
one is okay.
Yes.
Okay, good.
And it's going to be 4x8.
Mm-hmm. Pretty simple.
Very. Yeah. Nothing okay. fancy.
Tim, you're all right with that?
Yeah.
Looks good. Okay, good. All right, let's talk about the window graphic then.
So the window graphic is really. It's really to hide the inside of the building where there will be kids.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a big safety. That's why you see the last document I gave you, there's nothing there. It's just edge vinyl we're going to put on a window. We will put that on the outside to prevent the kids to peel it off and to eat it and do this
right.
kind of thing. So. And we will just cut out some the name of the place, and that's
yeah.
it. And we will be 50% of the height of the window.
Mm-hmm.
And why 50%? Because we think that it prevents the kids to really look outside. And when you're outside, you cannot really look into it.
Okay.
But it still put enough light in natural light in the building
mm-hmm.
to get the light during the summer.
How does that work for our 20%?
Well, I don't know.
That's where it gets.
I know it's a safety feature, having that. I mean, what do we think of that?
I think if, and we've looked at this before, that it is a graphic. It's not a sign. It's not intended to promote a specific business or
right.
element as part of that.
Okay.
You know, any lettering that promotes the business name, absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
But anything else than that is just it's just a graphic.
Okay. So then, really, it's only the sections of the. Vinyl that would be the sign part here of this new design that says the name of the business.
Yeah. Right. That so
would
it's
be
three on the one
factored.
Side and three on the other.
Correct.
It gets factored into it.
Yeah. I think
so at most you're looking at 50% of every third window.
At
so.
Which case you're still well under.
Well, I think plan business, which that is, I think it's 15%. You can't use 20. I think in plan business you use 15.
I think you're still like
I
if you're
still in good shape.
You're taking it to the in the aggregate of the whole thing.
Right.
That 50% of that of
yeah.
the window pane in three locations is still going to be underneath.
Exactly.
15%.
Okay. You're right, Kevin. Yeah. Okay. You're right. All right with that, Tim.
I like the green one better, but.
the landlord didn't want the green.
All right.
Okay. We have to deal with that.
Absolutely, I'm with you. Then otherwise, I think there's no issue.
Yeah, I think it looks good.
Straightforward.
Yeah, okay. Tim, you want to take this one?
Sure.
Yeah,
thanks. Matter of DRB 2019-19, the application of Kids Clubhouse of the Main Line. Move to approve the signage and awning.
I second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. Thanks, Tim. Next tonight is the application of DRB 2019-20, the application of AT&T at 230 East Lancaster Avenue in Wayne, for a ground sign, wall sign, window sign, and an awning. Hi there.
Hello there.
Hi. Okay.
Hi, I'm Mona Stearns from Cellular Concepts AT&T, and this is Sasha Stearns.
Okay, nice and loud, all right.
Nice. Okay, yeah. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Okay, so pretty much what we're doing is just replacing our existing sign because AT&T rebranded itself with capital letters mm-hmm. rather than the smaller letters. And in some of the signage, it's, which one do you want to start with, the awning?
Yeah, let's start with the awning.
Okay.
We're in awnings tonight, right?
Yeah. So currently we have the orange awnings, which we're now replacing with the new AT&T blue.
Okay.
It's 2.2 feet by 10 feet,
mm-hmm.
and it pretty much covers our front door.
No lettering or anything?
No lettering on the awning, yes.
Okay. All right. So I don't think we have any problem with that, do we?
No.
The only thing I wanted to ask you, though, the material on that.
Sunbrella.
It is Sunbrella. What's the term? I saw it in here.
It's
tempo test?
Tempo test, yes.
What's tempo test?
I apologize. I don't know. We were advised by AT&T as to what we could use,
mm-hmm.
and it's the Sunbrella tempo test, and then the color is designated by them as well.
Okay.
So,
all right.
I could find out, though.
Okay. As long as it's not like a vinyl material or anything.
No,
like that.
It's a cloth.
It's a cloth. Okay.
Yes.
All right, good. Okay. So are you with the awning?
Awning's fine.
Awning's fine?
Awning's fine.
Okay, good. All right. Why don't we look at the AT&T and the logo over the awning?
So over the awning
mm-hmm.
is we have the new AT&T globe and the larger letters, meaning the capital letters. So that's right here where we're doing the AT&T. It's the globe itself. The color is the same blue, and we're using approximately 24 square feet of space.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And if you see the old signage right above, which was on our old orange awning, that's what's being replaced.
I guess the only question I have, I don't know what you guys think. They're 24-inch letters. They're pretty big letters.
Especially in that area where we've been keeping it tight.
Yeah.
Right.
I'll speak for Colin, who's not here, and would speak up on that issue.
The other thing, too, I'm not too sure. They've
protected it in white.
Yeah, and they may have gone over 15.
Over 15 and
over from a height grade. It's kind of hard to tell.
The original that was there was what?
So if you're looking at the overall building height's 22 feet,
mm-hmm.
I think you're right. I think you're okay. The canopy was 6 feet. You add 8 to that for the door.
Mm-hmm.
Even 9. You're like right.
Just making it.
Yeah.
Just making it okay. So we get back to the letter size.
So our concern is the actual size of the letters, AT&T themselves. Our signage for letters have been 15 inches in height, right? And right now your current documentation is at, what was it?
24.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, you know, it's a good 9 inches over what usually we permit.
We just kind of want some consistency in town.
Certainly.
And the globe then would also, I mean,
well,
it clearly has
40
the space,
inches.
Exactly. So,
yeah. Right.
Does AT&T dictate the size to you or just the ratio?
Actually, they dictate, like this, so we work with a specific sign company, which is Jones Signs, and they kind of dictate depending on the building. The original building, I don't know if anybody remembers, but we had 3 awnings on it.
Right.
So they took, I think they take it into account, and you'd excuse me, I don't know all the details, but according to what I was told, according to Radnor Township rules, they said because of our 3 amounts of signage for the 3 awnings, they said that we could come to this, and this was what was recommended by AT&T, as this is what we need to work with.
So I think it calculates it based on square footage.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is fine. I'm just trying to, where do we
right.
size?
Aesthetics. Yeah. We just.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's trying to compete with each other for bigger and bigger signage, but in a spot like that, you're certainly going to see 15 or 18-inch letters from the road.
Oh, yeah.
If you can't, you know, yeah.
Yeah.
24 is kind of big. It's, I know, like, Wawa's got huge signs, but they've got a huge building, and it's got to kind of fit the building, but this building's not that big. for that kind of, you know, 40-inch globe or whatever, and 24-inch letters, but I don't know, you guys.
No, I think that it looks too big.
Yeah.
Just the optics of it looks bigger than I think it needs to be for that spot.
Plus with a huge ground sign out front, nobody's going to miss that building.
Yeah, I kind of forgot about that.
Yeah.
So I think our concern would be, I think we would want to see that the actual letters AT&T not exceed 15 inches in height. And so obviously that would change the ratio proportionally.
Would.
So the globe it reduces as well, right? So it doesn't change the ratio, it maintains it. So in the same sort of reduction in the letters, you're going to reduce the size of the globe as well, correct?
Which then centers it off of the midpoint. You might want to raise it up over the awning just slightly more than where it is now.
Right.
Right, to center it in the thing.
To center
Could
it.
Could we request something larger than the 18 inches, only because?
Or
15.
Well, sorry,
well,
15.
What do you think? I mean, 15, I think, is a nice figure, but can we give them?
Well, if you're looking at the 15, the globe then is going to be, I mean, I don't know what the ratio is, but the globe then itself will be whatever.
In proportion to it, it would reduce.
20 so to 12 it's, to 6 to 10 to...
So I'm looking at this right now. This is a sheet that's... So this one's different, right? Because it's showing that at 18 inches. But on the cut sheet or the spreadsheet calculating, this is page 3, or the S1 of the mm-hmm. horizontal, it's calling that out as 24 inches.
So 18 and 30.
Well, there's a discrepancy, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
can you live with 18?
I'm not gonna fight it.
Yeah. I think 18. I don't. Tim, what do you feel?
I wouldn't fight the 18.
18 and 30.
18 and 30.
So if it's per this exhibit that you're providing,
right,
we would agree. But if it's, you know, as what's cited on S1 for sign one, the sheet regarding that, we would say 24 is too much or too tall of a sign.
So I think that. Okay, I understand what you're saying.
All right, you want to go back to AT&T or Jones Signage or whoever?
Right. Would we be able to, because could we ask that we, if we submit the right thing, could we just like agree to that and then that's what we'll put? Or do we need to resubmit because we're just in a time crunch for this?
Not for
you. That's fine. And we'll approve per the condition that it meets this exhibit being provided. We'll say, mm-hmm. you know, approved
right.
per.
Right.
Okay.
For this.
So
okay.
then what you would do is then once you get the revised everything, you'd work with the township and
right.
they'll square everything away.
Okay. All right.
But so for our board's purposes, we'd be approving it subject to that condition. And if you meet that condition, then we don't need to come back to
18
us.
Inch and 30.
18 and 30.
30, yes.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay,
all
good.
Right. All right.
But we have all sorts of other stuff yet.
Yeah.
Yes, we do. We have two more things. So.
Okay, so we're good with the wall sign?
Subject to that condition, yes.
And we're okay with it projecting in white, right? Like it's not a white background. The letters are white, and that's
right.
okay.
Right.
Correct.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So let's look at the ground sign next.
So the ground sign is just.
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Yes, the globe will also be illuminated.
The globe is illuminated in blue. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it'll be fine with that.
I think that'll be fine.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay. The ground sign. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So the ground sign, pretty much, we're just changing the plate to the new AT&T color and mm-hmm. the new AT&T, as you can see, the level of the letters are the same. It's just in capital as opposed to small letters. And the word authorized retailer has been removed.
Okay.
Because we no longer have to say that.
I think it looks nice.
Thank you.
I think it'll be fine.
Thank you.
And with that, the only thing that's going to come through is it going to be
just the AT&T.
It's going to be the AT&T and the globe again?
Yes, sir.
And the black is not going to be illuminated?
Correct.
Okay.
That's an improvement.
Easy enough.
Yeah.
Yes, it's definitely an improvement. It looks much sharper. We've had it at a couple of other stores.
Yeah.
So.
So it's going to be a vinyl application on there? Or punch-out letters or just a flat face?
Flat face punch-out letters.
So it'll have some dimension or won't have any dimension? The sign?
The
letters?
Yes.
The letters will be flush, or they'll have a little dimension.
It's 3/16 of an inch.
Okay.
Dimension, so.
All right. It'll look a little better. Just a flat panel, I think.
It's flat.
Yeah.
The cutout, the AT&T is a cutout.
Okay.
But the blue will be something, either a vinyl applied behind that or...
Okay. All right, good. All right, what else?
Okay. And the last thing, we're just going to be redoing the lettering on our door, which is... The only difference is that it's just being centered and made a little bit smaller, believe it or not, so that the AT&T authorized retailer can be a little more centered and clearer and equidistant from each side of the door pane.
Okay.
So those are pretty much the changes.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. It's the hours really don't count on the square footage calculation, so they're fine.
All right. And they're identical to what it was.
Okay.
No change there.
All right. Any other comments from the board? Questions for the applicant? Tim, you're okay?
I think this is fine.
Do you guys have any other questions for us? You're okay with everything?
Yep.
Okay,
yep.
18 and 30?
18 and 30.
Okay.
All right.
Jason, you're all right with that?
Yeah, I'm okay with that.
All right, good. Is it I'm losing track? Your turn? Or?
Yeah, I'll do it.
Okay.
Okay, so in the matter of DRB 2019-20, the application for signage for AT&T at 230 East Lancaster Avenue in Wayne for both the ground sign, wall sign, and awning and window signage. I move to provide a provisional approval per the exhibit presented to us that stipulates that the letters for the AT&T are 18 inches and that the signage for the globe is 30 inches. Threw a line out there.
Okay.
So I move that it meets that exhibit as presented to us.
Okay, we're second.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
I approve.
Okay. Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
Thank you.
All right, moving right along. Next is DRB 2019-21, the application of Radnor Capital Management at 38 West Avenue in Wayne for a ground sign and a wall sign. Mr. Pyle, thank you for your patience. How are you doing tonight?
Doing well.
Good.
So I'm Doug Pyle, representing Radnor Capital Management. We just moved into the building at 38 West Avenue. It used to be an M&T bank building. Ida is our landlord. So here's a plot of the location. What we're proposing is merely replacing signs that M&T had in the previous signage.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The dimensions are laid out on this exhibit. It consists of a sign that goes into an existing tower, a sign that goes over the main door, and then signage at ground level to indicate both the address and entrance and exit.
Doug, we'll start with the pylon sign. So that was done fairly recently, I would say within the last 2 years. So I know it's in good shape and everything. I guess the only question is, again, just like the AT&T application that just came in, at nighttime, I think you're probably hearing from previous applications, the only thing that should be visible is the lettering and the logo.
Right.
The rest of it should be blacked out. The background should be black.
It could be illuminated. We decided not to have it illuminated at all.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Why is that?
And just sort of keep it low key.
Really? You know, okay.
It's not McDonald's.
All right. Okay. All right. That's interesting. Yeah.
If I may, I actually like that choice. So.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Good. All right. That's easy enough. And then the sign over the door?
Sign over the door is just replacing what M&T had before. It'd be a placard with a raised letter and the Radnor logo.
What kind of material are you going to use on that?
I think it's a plastic placard behind it and then raised letters that are also weatherproof.
Okay. No lighting?
No lighting.
You're saving on that Pico bill, aren't you? Yeah.
We have to save money for Aqua America.
Is that what it is? Okay. All right. Okay. What do you guys think? Questions?
So far, so good.
Yeah, I'm on board.
It's pretty clean application. The enter and exit signs, they meet the dimensions. You're allowed 4 feet max. They're well within that.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
Pretty easy, Doug. Yeah.
You're good.
Any other comments, questions?
No, I think it looks fine.
Doug, anything for us?
No.
Questions?
No,
okay. All right. I take that one, Tim.
In the matter of DRB 2019-21, the application of Radnor Capital Management, LLC, move to approve the application for ground sign and wall signs.
Your second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, Doug. Okay. Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
See you around town.
You bet.
Okay. All right. Last on the agenda tonight is DRB 2019-22, the application of Cornerstone Bistro and Artisanal Market, I hope I pronounced that right, at 1 West Avenue for outside dining. Hi there, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. I guess, you know, just before we get started, and we'll just kind of run through just a couple of the key points about the outside dining, since this is our first one of the season. The outside dining runs from April 1st to September 30th, 11 in the morning to 10 at night. There is a minimum of 48 inches of sidewalk space for pedestrians. Can't be any less than that. The furniture has to be like a cast iron, wrought iron, heavy aluminum, wood, something that's not going to blow all over town. There needs to be some sort of roof covering, whether it's an umbrella, awning, without any advertisement on it. And no signs advertising outdoor dining, and of course, no sandwich boards. And the final approval is up to the health department and the zoning officer on outside dining. So just, like I say, first one of the season, that's just kind of some of the ground rules that we're going to look at. So okay.
So Christine Condra, I'm the chef owner with my husband of Cornerstone. And this is our designer from Cullen Construction.
Nice to have you here.
Pardon me?
Nice to have you here.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Okay. So tell us what you have in mind.
Okay. So we're looking at adding 2 4-top tables to the outside of the front entrance, the main entrance of Cornerstone. They'd be high-top tables, 4 chairs at each table.
Okay. So you're saying in the front area of the building, where the doors are?
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. How about the area you have out there? We have adequate room? We have the 48-inch?
Yes.
You'll meet that requirement?
Correct.
Okay, good. Okay, and the type of tables and chairs you're going to use?
They're aluminum tables from Crate and Barrel, heavy wood frame, or they're aluminum frames, and then wood slats on the inside.
Okay.
So it's the same for the seat and the chair? Like the seat and the back are also the wood slats then?
It's all the same.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
And how about roof covering, something to protect the patrons and the food that's outside?
We can have, it actually has holes for umbrellas.
Okay.
So we can have an umbrella.
Okay, so an umbrella with no advertising.
Correct.
Okay. All right.
What color are they? Are they the color, the black color that's in this?
It would be the gray color.
The gray.
Okay.
It's like a dark black gray. Charcoal.
And then the umbrellas probably go with black, match your awning and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Is there any other tables you're looking to add, or is that pretty much it? So just 8 seats?
Yeah, correct.
Okay. I noticed going by that you have almost look like sofas out there right now. Are you consider those benches, or?
Those are just benches. They're just benches.
Okay.
That are out there.
Okay. All right. I guess there's adequate room for those.
Absolutely. I mean, they sit well within the double awnings that come down, or the 4 awnings that are out there. They sit within those awnings.
All right. So again, no sandwich boards, nothing that's going to advertise outside dining. Okay. You can look it all over yourself. It's all online there just to make sure. What other things? Questions?
So I would be cautious just a little bit. Some of the dimensions lines aren't, I'm looking at the one right at the beginning of the door swing. It's not necessarily perpendicular to the facade itself. And so what's necessary is 48 inches, right, for ADA accessibility. But my only concern is that it is a side entrance or a side approach to that door and not, you're not coming in perpendicular to that. And so I think it does increase that because it's a side approach by 6 inches. I don't know off the top of my head. And so now you're at 52 inches, which you're close. It's just close. But again, my concern is that it's an angled dimension and not perpendicular to the facade. So, okay, you know, per code, and not just Radnor, I mean, we're talking ADA, right? Mm-hmm. That has to be perpendicular, yes, to that, to the facade, and I think it has to be 52 inches. So I would just sort of verify that dimension, okay, per the install. Now, granted, you're not installing these in a no, permanent manner, so, permanent, you know, that could be moved. It's, yeah, just that you have to maintain 52 clear, and it becomes an operational issue, right? Like, you're just making sure. You're not going out there with a tape measure, but you're just making sure. No, you have the adequate clearance.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, just getting back to the benches out there, I know you said like a pillows out there, cushions of some sort. They need to be a fire retardant material.
They are.
So just make sure of that. All right. Okay. All right. What else, guys? Tim? Is there anything else?
I mean, it's not really clear here from the drawing, but keep adequate clearance from the tables to the garden area. Otherwise, I don't really see any issue.
Okay. Kevin, comments?
And this shouldn't come as a surprise. I have expressed concern about the spatial requirements up there with the tables. When they're put in, there are accessibility regulations that we'll need. And I believe that there is, when you have a landing or a turn, that dimension is no longer 48 inches. It may actually go up to 60 inches. So this would be something that we would be looking at, having our third-party plan review look at for compliance with ADA regulations, okay, from that standpoint. So just be mindful of that. You know, and as I mentioned to you before, that it may look okay on paper. When you actually install it, somebody can fall backwards. You know, if the edge of the chair, mm-hmm, to meet that is right on the edge of the pavement, and to get in and out, you're into the garden, that could be a problem.
Unlike
so
many other places, our doors actually are double doors. So there is well enough.
I'd say if the chair that's on the back side of the table by the garden, you don't have enough room. Until we actually look at a formal plan, review it for ADA compliance, and when you put it in and an inspection is done at that point, we're not really going to know. Those are things that I mentioned when you dropped off the application.
No, I know, but this is actually different from what I dropped off, because this is now completely the scale, and it's smaller tables and smaller chairs.
Okay. But you're also coming in, as was mentioned, on an angled approach. So there is a turn and there is a kind of a landing requirement. And I think it's 60 inches
diameter for ADA compliance.
Correct.
It's a clear circle of 60 inches, essentially, to be able to turn. And I think the third party review would probably be most beneficial because it does sort of, I'm not an expert in it. I just know enough to be dangerous.
Well, our third party reviews all of our plans, so this isn't something special.
We're not bringing
this
something in. It has to happen.
Yes, and again, we don't have any, as you are aware, any forgiveness or ability to relax
ADA
accessibility. ADA is federal, but Pennsylvania's adopted the accessibility standards, and that is through Harrisburg for any relief.
The only thing that gets sort of in the conversation between us, the only thing that gets weird is because it's furniture. Right.
If it's
a built-in piece, it's a different beast.
Which is why we're going to have the consultant review these as they do all of our building plans.
Right. Right.
If necessary to meet these and to just balance these out, is there the ability to move the tables more towards the tree and towards the parking spaces? Is that within your rights to do that, or is that outside of it?
That's within your rights to do that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's actually our property.
Okay.
Yeah. It's not the township's. So we can absolutely move it. And
I know you want to stay away from the cars because you don't want to eat next to a car. But yeah.
No, I mean, in order for it to be, this is the first that I'm hearing about this, about the ADA compliance. And I'm just curious as to when other people are going up, have they all had to go before ADA? Does ADA have to come in?
It's universally applied.
No, I mean, for anybody else, have they been So is there sightings on that I can look and see that all the restaurants had to have ADA compliance?
This is the preliminary review. We don't deal with the health of the ADA stuff for what we look at here. This is the preliminary look at this. So that's outside of this board's purview.
And when is that done?
When an application, so there's a two-part approval process for outdoor dining, for outdoor dining and for construction on anything that's coming from this board. This is part one, the aesthetics, what it's going to look like, what it's going to be constructed out of, and then the actual plan review to issue the outdoor dining license. At that point, it was previously done in-house by in-house code officials. It's now, because of change of staffing, is being done by a third-party agency.
So what you're coming here for is for us to say whether we like how it looks.
Yeah.
And we do. I think at this point we do. Yeah. So we're just giving you just our concerns for certain things down the road that we see.
This is not a structure that's being built in by any stretch of the means.
And this is the positioning of the tables is from an aesthetic standpoint, and from a practicality standpoint, that's kind of what you're here for. And what I said about being too close to the garden area, that's just, I know how well I get in and out of the chair. That's just me making a common sense statement. But that's all we're looking at this point. But so with our comments being made and subject to you having to go get your other further approval.
So what is that process? Because I've had multiple conversations and this didn't come up.
I'm sorry, what didn't come up?
It was to come in and get this was the approval and then we have the outdoors.
You and I had a conversation
I'm not talking about any conversations that we've had. I'm just saying with other people that I've had conversations with within the township. What is the next step after this?
Well, I can't speak to other conversations. The conversation you and I had was this is the first step, and then you would submit for the actual license.
Right. So then what is the process?
There is an application for the outdoor dining license. You submit that review. We're averaging a week to a week and a half for smaller things like this, so it's generally very quick. Our code officials plus our health officers review those.
Kevin, I know flower pots are kind of a sticky point with outside dining.
It's by code prohibited.
Right.
And it's always a battle on those that were pre-existing prior to that code regulation coming in with the change to the code. I tried to find that the hours were actually extended. I think we go out to the end of November and possibly the beginning of March. I know we extended those when we redid and brought outdoor dining throughout the township. But I couldn't pull up the specific regulation on the e-code website. But when we went through and amended that ordinance to expand outdoor dining, that was something that was under the food code that planters were prohibited. So as a zoning regulation, there are some establishments that are grandfathered in. It's always the battle of were they there for existing ones and trying to catch them, kind of like the sidewalk signs.
Okay.
Things like that.
So what you are being put to is the normal course of things. What people probably don't tell you about is us, because we don't do much on this. We give you the stamp of approval, and then you go and get the licensing. So that's where we're at this stage. So if somebody told you something different, it was probably because they forgot about us.
Oh, no. I knew about this process.
Okay.
Okay. Any other comments, questions? Hmm? Jason, you all right?
Yeah, I'm okay.
Questions, comments? You guys are all right? Okay. All right. Tim? Okay.
In the matter of DRB 2019-22, the application of Cornerstone Bistro and Artisanal Market, motion to approve the application for outdoor dining.
Your second?
I second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yep. Thank you.
Okay. Good night now. All right. Any other business for our board tonight? Motion for dismissal?
Yeah, I second.
All right. Let's go. All right. See you next month.
All right.